Hey everyone, it's Bobby from Lego Birds with another video in my Bird ID Through the Year series, and this one is going to be a brief introduction to inland gulls. A lot of people, of course, associate gulls with the ocean, but you can find a lot of them far inland as well. And this certainly is not going to be 100% comprehensive to everything that can show up in inland areas, but it should give you a good foundation. But the specific species you have in your area could vary quite a bit depending on exactly where you are. So I'm going to focus this on my area of central Pennsylvania. So if you are in another area, you could see some different species as well. First up, we have ring-billed gull. And this is very comfortably the default species that you would expect in my area. And if somebody just pointed to a random gull without even looking at it, if I just called it a ring-billed gull, I'd be right probably about 99% of the time. But of course, you want to have some field marks to be able to back up that claim. So the adults have a yellow bill with the namesake black ring around it. And the bill is a nice medium size. Of course, in terms of plumage, they're mostly white on the underside and have sort of a lighter gray on the upper side with black wingtips, but that's pretty typical with adult gulls. So typically you're not going to use the plumage features unless you have multiple birds that you're comparing to. And then you can maybe use the shade of gray to help to pick out some rarer species. And the immature ring-billed gulls have sort of a messier plumage. It's a little browner. They also have a pink bill with a black tip, and you can see this immature standing with two adults. And here's a nice example of a group of ring-billed gulls that's flying up the river. You can see a number of immatures mixed into this group. If you want to pause it and try and pick out all of them, feel free, but these all appear to be ring-billed gulls. And next up we have American herring gull, or sometimes you'll see it referenced as herring gull. But most taxonomic authorities are starting to come around to treating the American ones as a distinct species from the others found around the world. The adult plumage is very similar to ring-billed gull, with the mostly white with gray on the back and then the black wingtips. But American herring gulls are quite a bit larger and bulkier, and they have a heavier bill that has some red on it or can also have some black. And if you're seeing them up close, you can see that herring gull has pink legs, whereas ring-billed gull has yellow legs. And immature American herring gulls are usually much darker overall than immature ring-billed gulls, and they usually have a light head. Oftentimes, herring gulls will mix in with the ring-billed gulls, and usually they're pretty easy to pick out. You can see these two are much larger gulls compared to all of the surrounding birds, and you can see that little bit of a heavier bill with just the red spot. And on this picture, you can see a lot of immatures mixed in with ring-billed gulls, and these stand out pretty easily normally. You can see, for example, this one larger and darker with a heavier bill, usually with the pale head. So we went larger than ring-billed gull with American herring gull, and now we go smaller than ring-billed gull with Bonaparte's gull. And the plumage on these is a lot more distinctive compared to ring-billed and American herring gulls. In breeding plumage, they have a completely black head, or in non-breeding plumage, you'll see that just becomes a little black spot behind the eye. And they have a different wing pattern. So you can see there's a lot of white in the underwing, and instead of having extensive black in the tip, it's just the very edge of the outermost primaries, just giving this slight black trailing edge to the outer part of the wing here. And the outermost primaries are also whiter, so you can see this white stripe in the outer part of the wing, and that stands out even at quite a distance on the adults. And then the immatures have a little bit of a different plumage. You can see the black trailing edge in the wing, and then you get kind of the dark stripes here, but you can see that same facial pattern with the dark spot, and then it has that thin black bill like the adults. And here's a little survey of photos just so you can see some of the variation in the field. Again, you can see all of these in breeding plumage. And then this is some Bonaparte's gulls mixed in with some ring-billed gulls. You can see the Bonaparte's gulls in front. And again, you can see a mixed group here with three Bonaparte's gulls and two ring-billed gulls. And then we have just this group of Bonaparte's gulls. And again, you can see that different wing pattern with the white stripe out in the outer part of the wing with that just very thin black trailing edge. And I will conclude with just a very quick introduction to some of the rarer inland species in the East. And this first group is going to be the ones that have a more similar plumage to Bonaparte's gulls, specifically with that black hood. So you have black-headed gull and little gull, which are both visitors from Europe, so they are not really that common anywhere in North America. And then we have Franklin's gull, which is very abundant in the middle of North America, but a little more rare as you get towards the East Coast. And finally, laughing gull is incredibly common in coastal areas, but not that common as you get farther inland. And then we have the larger gulls, and if we start with the pale ones, you have Iceland gull, which is sort of similar in size to herring gull, and then you have the larger glaucous gull, and then you have the two dark-backed ones, so you have lesser black-backed gull, which is an increasing visitor from Europe, and then you have great black-backed gull, which is the largest gull species in the world. And in terms of distribution, great black-backed gull is very common in coastal areas. Lesser black-backed gull is sort of increasing in numbers, especially as you get more towards coastal areas. And then Iceland and Glaucus are usually found a little farther north. So there you have my introduction to inland gulls. So like I said, definitely not 100% comprehensive, but practically speaking in the field, this is going to cover 99%+ of the situations you're in inland areas in Pennsylvania. Please like and subscribe and consider signing up to my daily bird ID quizzes at lycobirds.com/email. It's free and easy to unsubscribe at any time. And I hope to see you there, and I hope to see you in my next video. Thanks for watching.